It's the 10th video in my series about fluids, hemodynamics, electrolytes, acid-base disturbance, etc. Today let's talk about osmolality and tonicity. Are they the same? Are they kind of different? Let's find out and let's get started. Some words of wisdom. Quote, there are two great days in a person's life, the day we were born and the day we discover why. Amazing. First, let me answer the question of the previous lecture for you. Your 52-year-old male patient is on loop diuretics to manage his hypertension. When he first started using the diuretics, what did his osmolality and ECF volume look like? So diuretics in general make you lose more salt than water. Don't ever forget that. So let's start with our silver equation. We have total body sodium over total body water, and they happen to equal or are related to serum sodium concentration. Very cool. So what happened here when you lose more sodium than water? Guess what will happen to the serum sodium concentration? It's gonna decrease. When serum sodium concentration decreases, what will happen to the plasma osmolality? Decreases, because it's mainly dependent on sodium. So when the plasma osmolality decreases, and here's your cell, and here's the extracellular fluid. What will happen when the osmolality outside decreases? Water is gonna shift from the ECF into the ICF, because now the ICF is more concentrated. It's called osmosis. So now the plasma osmolality decreases, so the y-axis on the graph has to decrease. A, it increases, so it cannot be the correct answer. B, it's the same, cannot be the answer. C, the y-axis didn't go down, so it's not the answer. D is the only one where the y-axis or plasma osmolality decreased from here to here. So D is the answer, but let's continue. When water shifts from the ECF into the ICF, the ECF is going to shrink, so the volume is going to decrease. We decrease the x-axis. And the ICF is going to expand because water is moving into the cell. We expand the ICF volume over the x-axis. If you got it right, wonderful. If you got it wrong, learn from your mistakes. What do you want me to do? So easy. For the gazillion time, cell membrane transport is either passive or active. Passive, no ATP, such as osmosis. Osmosis is simple diffusion of water, because it's simple diffusion goes from high concentration of water to low concentration of water across a semipermeable membrane. You can say from low concentration of solute to high concentration of solute, which is the exact same thing. Osmotic pressure is the pressure needed to stop osmosis, which happened to be equal the pressure of osmosis. Osmole is osmosis caused by a mole. We care about the number of particles and not the mass or the size. Osmolality is the amount of force per volume measured in milliosmole per kilogram. How about osmolarity? It's per liter. Measured osmolality versus calculated osmolality. Measure osmolality, just draw some blood, send it to the lab. The osmometer is going to do the job, and it's counting how many osmoles in the plasma. Calculated osmolality is different. We calculate it using our brains. The equation, 2 times sodium plus glucose over 20 plus BUN over 3. Normally, measured should equal calculated osmolality, or at least the difference is less than 10. But what if the difference is more than 10? Measured osmolality is greater than calculated osmolality by a margin greater than 10. It's called the osmolar gap, the difference between them. If it's less than 10, no problem. It's more than 10. Houston, we got a problem. It's called high osmolar gap. Let's go fishing. There is a toxin in your body, and let's go find it. Effective osmolality, the nephrologist said, hey guys, urea is BS. Why? Because it's not effective. It keeps going into the cell and out of the cell across the membrane. It cannot stay in one location. If it cannot stay in one location, it cannot cause osmosis. So it's not effective. Yes, it's counted by the stupid osmometer, but we don't care. It's not effective. So let's remove it from the equation and just have the sodium and glucose. Those are the two main effective osmoles. Okay, nephrologist. You guys are useless anyway. Who needs a nephrologist? So if you go to any stupid textbook to see the definition of osmolality and tonicity, here is what you're gonna find. Osmolality is the total number of osmoles, or solute, in a volume of water. Tonicity is the ability of the combined effect of all solutes to generate an osmotic driving force that causes water movement. Did you understand anything? Of course not. That's why medicosis is here. Pay attention. So here is how you tell the story. Osmolality is just the stupid osmometer counting all of the stupid osmoles in your plasma. That's it. Tonicity depends only on the effective osmoles. So it described osmolality relative to the plasma, and therefore fluids are either hypotonic when their osmolality is less than that of the plasma, or isotonic when their osmolality is equal to the plasma, around 290 milliosmoles per liter, or hypertonic when the osmolality of that solution is greater than the plasma. So what is the normal plasma osmolality? I would say from 275 to 295. If you say 300, it's okay. Anything less than 275 is called hypotonic. Anything greater than 295 or greater than 300, we call this hypertonic. Both are bad. Isotonic is the best. Remember this question, like number 8, when we used to calculate this? This is osmolality, this is not tonicity, because we are not comparing this to the plasma. So, here we count sodium and chloride, these are two, because it's an ionizable thing. If you have glucose, it's non-ionizable, so the answer here is 1, but it's in a half a liter, trick, so the answer is 2. Here we have 1 mole of calcium chloride, so here are 3, 1 calcium and 2 chlorides, and 6 moles of sodium chloride, 6 times 2 is 12, so 3 plus 12 is 15, in a half a liter. So in 1 liter, the answer is 30. When we calculate the osmoles in the plasma, this is osmolality, this is not tonicity. When we judge a solution and we call it hypotonic, isotonic, or hypertonic, this is tonicity. And if you pay attention, osmolality doesn't care if you are an effective osmole or not. It counts everything, including the stupid calcium chloride, who no one cares about. But tonicity is different. Tonicity is an effective osmolality relative to the plasma. Hypotonic, isotonic, or hypertonic. What is the main determinant of plasma osmolality or tonicity? The king, sodium. Why? Because it's very numerous. There is a lot of sodium in the extracellular fluid, and osmosis only cares about the number of particles. Urea is BS. It's not an effective osmole, so it has nothing to do with tonicity. It's an ineffective osmole. And here are the three definitions. Very easy. Hypertonic, if your osmolality is greater than that of the plasma. Hypotonic, if your osmolality is less than that of the plasma. And normal tonicity, or normal tonic, when your osmolality equals that of the plasma. Very easy stuff. I'm trashing urea because urea is ineffective. So what are the effective osmoles? They are solutes that are confined to the ECF and cannot cross through the lipid bilayer membrane. Therefore, they are capable of exerting an osmotic pressure and causing an osmotic gradient and leading to flow of water. Example, let's say that you have a foreign toxin in your body, such as methanol, for example. Is it an effective osmole? Yes, it keeps draining water. It's an effectively, osmotically active. How about sodium? Oh, yeah, it's the king. Glucose, yes. Sorbitol and mannitol, yep. So when you were like in kindergarten, you learned like there is a difference between thirsty and hungry. But what stimulates your thirst sensation? The main stimulant for thirst is hypertonicity. Hypertonicity is when the plasma osmolality is greater than 295. It stimulates the osmoreceptors in your hypothalamus. Hypothalamic neurons synthesize the ADH, antidiuretic hormone, and the ADH is gonna pass into the posterior pituitary, which did not synthesize the ADH, but is gonna capitalize on it, and it's gonna secrete the ADH into the blood. This is called an endocrine process. When you secrete something into the blood, it's called endocrine. When you secrete something to the extracellular or transcellular fluid around you, like the interstitial fluid, we call this paracrine and not endocrine. Endocrine is to the blood. Cool. What does the ADH do? It's an anti-diuretic hormone. So it's anti-diuresis. Diuresis is loss of water in the kidney. So it's going to reabsorb water in the nephrons and it's not going to let water pass through the urine. It's also known as vasopressin. Vaso means blood vessel. Pressin means to contract. So it contracts your blood vessel. So when you are hypertonic, you will drink water and you don't pee it, because we need water to decrease your plasma osmolality. Got it? We are drinking water to increase water in, and at the same time, we are not losing water out. Let's talk about ADH. Antidiuretic hormone prevents water from being lost by the kidney. Where exactly in the kidney? Please be specific. The collecting tubules. They have the V2 receptors, also known as arginine vasopressin receptor 2. Arginine vasopressin happens to be the same thing as ADH, stupid people. So here is your collecting tubule and it has the V2 receptor. This V2 receptor gets activated by the ADH, antidiuretic hormones. When that receptor binds to the ligand or to the hormone, these channels are gonna open. They are called aquaporine, protein channels for water, for the aqua. And then water is gonna flow from the tubule to the peritubular capillaries to the blood. This is called reabsorption, and less water is gonna be lost in the urine. Wonderful. What type of water this is? It's a free water. It doesn't follow electrolytes. Arginine vasopressin. It's a peptide hormone because anything that ends in IN is a protein. So ADH binds to the V1 receptor, also known as arginine vasopressin receptor 1. And it's found in the, like, when you constrict blood vessels, what really are you constricting? You're constricting your arterioles. These are your resistant vessels. They have large portion of smooth muscles. You contract them, causing vasoconstriction in order to keep the pressure in. When you constrict your blood vessel, you are increasing your arterial blood pressure. So the antidiuretic hormone is keeping the water in the body, which is gonna increase the effective arterial blood pressure. And it's constricting your arterioles, which is gonna increase your arterial blood pressure because you were thirsty, you were hypertonic. We need to increase the water in your body. By collapsing the arterioles against it, increasing the pressure, and preventing the loss of water. As you know, not all waters are created equal. We have the obligated water and the free water. Which of these two is being dealt with by the ADH? It's the free water. ADH only deals with free water using the V2 receptors, opening the aquaporin 2 channels. Free to live, free to choose, which is a book by Milton Friedman. Here's your kidney and your collecting tubules here. Here is the nephron, also known as the tubule. But here are the arteries and veins and capillaries and vessels. This is the afferent, then efferent, then peritubular capillaries. And here is the same peritubular capillary. When you pass from the tubule to the peritubular capillary, this is called reabsorption. The opposite process is called secretion. So we would like to reabsorb water, please. Okay, ADH is gonna bind to the V2 receptor, opening the aquaporin 2 channels, leading to the passage of water from the tubule to the peritubular capillary. Less water is gonna be lost in urine. Water didn't follow sodium. Water went by its own, on its own, free to choose. This is called a free water, not an obligated water. That's why hypertonicity was the main stimulant for ADH secretion, and ADH is gonna reduce that tonicity back to normal. Amazing. The main stimulant for thirst is hypertonicity. The main stimulant for ADH release, again, is hypertonicity. When you lose pure water, this increases the serum sodium concentration because suddenly we now have relatively more sodium. And remember the silver equation, serum sodium concentration equals total body sodium over total body water. When you lose pure water, this is water, sorry, this is water. When you lose lots of water, what will happen to the serum sodium concentration? If the total body sodium remains constant, the answer is it's gonna go up. Increase serum sodium concentration. This will lead to hypertonicity because the king of tonicity and osmolality is the sodium. This will lead to two things. Increase thirst sensation. Why? To make you drink water in order to bring tonicity back to normal. Decrease tonicity. And it will stimulate ADH. Why? To reabsorb water and decrease water loss. And this will decrease tonicity and back to normal. When you're hypertonic, you become thirsty. So there is no need to download an app to track how many cups of water you drink a day. Some people will pay money for that app. My goodness, humanity is in trouble. But this app is cool and it keeps sending me notifications to stay hydrated. Shut up! You already have osmoreceptors in your hypothalamus. They already do this for you for free, you selfish, ungrateful twit. My goodness, humanity is in trouble. Remember, calculated osmolality depends on the big three. Glucose is an effective osmole, but compared to sodium, it's less significant. Why is that? Because sodium normally is 140, and it's bound to something such as chloride, and then we multiply it by 2, one for the sodium and one for the chloride. 2 times 140 is what? It's 280. That's a lot of osmoles. Glucose is normally 100. So 100 over 20 is 5. 5 compared to 280 is nothing. I'm not saying glucose is significant, but compared to sodium, it's less significant. Of course, if you have a brain. Under normal conditions, glucose is insignificant in terms of tonicity. Sodium is king. But in uncontrolled diabetes, when you have hyperglycemia, it can be 600. So if you divide 600 over 20, cancel 0 with 0, 690 over 2 is 30. That's a lot. 5 now is 30. And sometimes in uncontrolled diabetes, we can see numbers in the 900s in terms of serum glucose concentration. So, yeah, in cases of uncontrolled diabetes, yeah, it can be a big deal. But normally, nah. What happens in hyperglycemia? Glucose becomes significant, leading to hypertonicity because it's increased plasma osmolality. This will lead to ICF contraction because water is flowing from the ICF into the ECF. Now the cell is gonna shrink. Make believe that this is your brain, you get mental status abnormalities. That's why you get coma in cases of hyperglycemia. And we call this hyperosmolar hyperglycemic non-ketotic syndrome. So increased plasma osmolality is usually due to hyperglycemia or hypernatremia. Now let's finish talking about urea once and for all. Urea is an osmole, yes. It affects plasma osmolality when measured by the stupid osmometer. The answer is yes. But it's not an effective osmole. It keeps moving between ECF and ICF. It does not create an osmotic gradient. Urea is BS. It doesn't affect tonicity and it's not an effective osmole. I have swollen because of urea. Said no cell ever. There is no such thing as cell swelling or cell shrinking because of increased BUN. This is BS. So let's wrap it up. Tonicity determines cell hydration, which determines the cell size through osmosis. Hypertonicity, the cell will shrink. Hypotonicity, the cell will swell. What makes you thirsty? The main stimulant is hypertonicity. Increase angiotensin 2 and extracellular fluid volume depletion, especially if severe. That's why there is no need to download an app to track your hydration, you stupid idiot. My goodness, humanity is in trouble. Why you keep repeating yourself? I have Alzheimer's dementia. Don't judge me. My favorite part of the lecture is the clinical take-home points. Normal people rarely develop hypernatremia. Why? Their thirst sensation is intact. Their ADH is intact. Too much ADH increased free water reabsorption leading to hyponatremia. Remember the silver equation. In cases of syndrome of inappropriate ADH secretion, this is what happens, such as a smoker for 30 years who develops small cell lung cancer can end up with SIADH. In cases of SIADH, the more water you drink, the lower your serum sodium is gonna be. remember the silver equation. So if you have SIADH, please restrict water. Too little ADH means less reabsorption of free water. You end up with hypernatremia, such as cases of diabetes insipidus, such as in patients with a history of a recent brain surgery, brain tumor, or a head trauma. On your exam, whatever your exam, if you're an American, in the UK, Australia, Canada, India, whatever, whenever you see a patient on your test with a serum sodium less than 120, the diagnosis is always SIADH, and the only question is what's causing it. So, quiz time, and this is the 11th question. All of the previous questions are on the playlist. Which of the following scenarios do you expect to find in a male smoker for 40 years with a lung tumor? Here is the normal, and on the x-axis you have the plasma ADH level, and on the y-axis you have the serum plasma osmolality. Go! Let me know the answer down below in the comments. The answer is gonna be on my Facebook and in the next video, so don't forget to subscribe and hit the bell to get notified. Follow me on Facebook. Please consider supporting this channel on Patreon, patreon.com/medicosis. Thank you so much. Until next time, be safe, stay happy, and study hard.